Amen to that. Good morning again. No doubt, studying the book of Matthew on to chapter 2 we go today. And I'm going to have our friend Miss Emily come up and read for us the scripture today. Why don't you stand with us this morning? It'll be on the screens. Please stand. And Emily's going to read to us the first six verses of Matthew chapter 2 today. By the way, are you ready for Christmas in April? Christmas in April today, okay? All right, so here we go. A beautiful day, but thank you. How are you? How was San Diego? Great?
Yes, fun.
Blessing?
Yes.
Oh, praise the Lord. All right, you can read it there. I'll put it here too. Matthew 2, verse 1, and then we'll go down to verse number 6, okay? Oh, you need this. There you go. Thank you.
Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him, and assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it's written by the prophet. And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel."
Can you give a hand to Miss Emily? Good job. Stay up here with me. Let's pray for the people, okay? Will you agree with me? Lord Jesus, thank you for our people, these youth and adults who we love them all. We thank you for them. Thank you for bringing them out today. Thank you for bringing us through this last week. Lord, all blessings come from you, the blessings we received. Lord, even the trouble maybe we had this week, you still take care of us. You see us through. And Lord, as we look at Matthew 2, the beginning of the greatest story ever, your birth, and now you're a child, Lord, and all the circumstances around that. You're powerful. We love you. We praise you. Help us to learn more about you and to draw closer to you, Lord Jesus. We ask this in your name. Everybody said, amen. You can be seated this morning. Let these kings know you love them. You appreciate our students this morning. All right. Now, we've all heard of Christmas in July, right? Now, I haven't looked. I pray there's not any Christmas trees at Costco yet, but they'll be there soon. We know that. By at least July anymore, you can't even get through July 4th quite. Thank you, gentlemen. And there's Christmas trees out. It comes earlier all the time. Thank you, man. Appreciate that so much. But I thought as we go through Matthew, what great timing is chapter 2 that we revisit this story today. And that's what we're doing as we get to Matthew chapter 2. My opening thought for you this morning, ladies and gentlemen, is are you desperate for Jesus today? Are you desperate for him? I'm going to show you some people. Some were, some were not. And it's a key that we are not just desperate if we haven't accepted him as our Lord and Savior, but it's a key that we're desperate for him all of our lives after we come to him. Wise men and astronomers, they're astronomers. They come from the east in our story. They're called magi. You probably know that. It's where we get our word magic. So not only were they studying, of course, the stars, but they were also into astrology. Now, it's not just three kings. We have that song that someone wrote that we're familiar with when we get around Christmas time. Would have been many more people than three kings. It's an entire caravan of people are coming from the northeast down into, they're going to end up in Bethlehem, but it's Jerusalem where they're coming from. Now, they come from what is now either Iran or Saudi Arabia. Is it interesting to you for 2,000 years plus? It is to me. But the last 2,000 years that Iran or Persia has been connected to Israel? Isn't that interesting? And they're still connected. Not in a good way, but there's still connection between those countries and there were 2,000 years ago. If this caravan came from there, and very possibly it did, if it did not come from Saudi Arabia. It's 900 to 1,100 miles would have been what this caravan of people traveled. And they're coming across the desert, of course, on camels. Now, I've ridden on a camel not very far when we went to Jerusalem. Probably a lot of us who've taken tours have ridden a camel. Let me tell you something, it is not comfortable. It's not a comfortable ride at all. Very bumpy, as you can imagine. And if you're going across sand, which they were, that's desert out there, those hooves are going down a little bit. So it's pretty bumpy to go these many miles to travel across the desert. How long do you think it took? Right? We see in this story, we're going to see that we saw last week, of course, Jesus is born, baby. Now when we get to our story today, he's a child. So it took a little bit of time. How long do you think a caravan of people, let's say from Iran, Persia then, to go down first stop Jerusalem? How long do you think it took? 3 months. Did you say 2 years, someone? And I know you said that, which is very good, because when they get, well, we know that Herod's going to do something that lets us know 2 years or less. But you might be right, Richard. It may have been 3 months, because we know camels can walk 40 miles a day. But that's not considering a human body, a man, on top of that camel. And then if they loaded, which they did, some of their goods on that camel's going to walk slower in the sand. So anywhere, I think for sure, from a month to 3 months, and it may have been even closer to just under 2 years, it would take them to go across the desert heading down there. Now, they've got to keep vigilant watch because there's robbers out there in the desert, and those robbers, those thieves, if they knew what was in this caravan, as we'll see, there are some goods in this caravan that are coming across the desert. Now, Jesus is referred to as a child now, so we know it's been a little bit of time since he was born, that baby unto Mary and Joseph, as we saw last week. So they come, they think he will be born in Jerusalem. Why not? The King of Kings, the King of the Jews, why wouldn't he be in David's city? Makes sense. But they're going to find him in Bethlehem. A lot of us know this story. That's where he's at. So why Bethlehem? Well, I'm glad you asked this morning. Number one, Bethlehem is the ancestral home of David. If you were here last week, we talked about David 1, genealogy, that David is an ancestor to Jesus. It's the lineage of the kings. And so David's town, his hometown, is Bethlehem. It makes sense about that. Jesus is from the family of David. Number two, he fulfills prophecy, number two, which is in our series of No Doubt. Now, my goal, my plan these months as we go through the summer is I'm going to give you all kinds of reasons. There's so many prophecies and predictions fulfilled in Matthew that one, you'll have no doubt that Jesus Christ is Lord. No doubt he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. No doubt there's no one like Jesus Christ ever. So that's my goal going through Matthew, because he's going to give us all these prophecies and fulfillments hundreds of years before that Jesus fulfills. Super cool. And here's our second one. Last week was the virgin birth. No one else ever born like that. No one else will ever be born like that in future history. And if you look at Micah 5:2 today or this week, Micah would predict 700 years later or 700 years before that the Messiah is going to be born in Bethlehem. Now, he had to be scratching his head too. Micah had to be thinking, Lord, am I hearing this right? And again, the writers of the Bible, these men, they would write history, or they would write what God would give to them. But I wonder if they questioned and said, Bethlehem, why Bethlehem? The Messiah's got to be born in Jerusalem. Am I hearing you right? Lord, that still small voice we talked about last week. Am I hearing you right? Bethlehem? Yes, Bethlehem. And he wouldn't have known that 700 years later, there would be a census taken for the entire Roman Empire at this time. And you can see that if you go over to Luke chapter 2 this week and remind yourself of the rest of the Christmas story. He wouldn't have known that, but he wrote faithfully what God gave to him. Okay, God, I'm going to write Bethlehem, and Bethlehem is the place. Now, I love this. God just has it all together for us, ladies and gentlemen. Bethlehem means the house of bread. The house of bread is where Jesus is going to be born, in that city. So what? Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Who loves it? Who loves how God puts it all together for us? The house's bread is where the bread of life, what you need for life, even greater than eating anything else, including bread, the meaning of life, Jesus Christ. Well, he should be born in a city that's called the house of bread, don't you think? I think that is so cool. I love it how he ties it all together. So Joseph took his family. They had to return to their ancestral home. Takes his family home to the city of their ancestors. We know that's David's city, and of course, that's Bethlehem. Now, let's compare the desperation today of the Magi, King Herod, and the chief priests regarding Jesus, okay? Again, my main thing for you today is, are you desperate for Jesus? Are you desperate for him today? Or what's your level of desperation to him? Well, these people all had different levels of desperation unto Jesus. So the Magi, they're desperate to find the king. They follow an incredible star. Now, they're astronomers, remember, so they're looking up at the sky. They understand those signs in the sky. That star got their attention. Some scholars say it was a conjunction between Jupiter and Saturn. They came together. Here's that bright star in the sky. Other scholars say it was a supernova, that a star exploded. And this caravan of men and people saw that explosion. But these just don't make sense to me, folks. This star moved and led them to Bethlehem. It wasn't just an explosion on one night. You said it. It might have taken 3 months. It may have taken 6 months. It might have been almost 2 years. Across the desert, this star, not one-time explosion, leading them across the desert. This star moved and led them to Bethlehem. It's a supernatural star from God. Is that hard for you to believe? Why wouldn't God do that? This is the beginning of the greatest story ever told. Why wouldn't it be spectacular? When you go to Luke, there's shepherds out in the fields, right? Who declares to them about the baby child, about the Messiah? It's a bunch of angels light up the sky. Spectacular! Glory to God in the highest, and peace on earth to men. God does spectacular things, and he gets our attention. And there's no doubt in my mind, it's a supernatural star from God, because he's announcing the birth of his only begotten son. It's going to be supernatural. So the Magi had it all. They had knowledge, well educated. They had power because they did dabble in then witchcraft. So they had evil power, that part of the world that they came from, but they had power. And yet, they're still not satisfied. You say, well, Pastor Drew, how do you know? How do you know they weren't satisfied? I know how we all are. We hate traffic, do we not? We talked about it last week. We hate lines at Disneyland. We hate traffic on the freeways. We're not going to travel any further than we have to. These people traveling 1,000 miles across the desert on camels, they had to be desperate. They had to be desperate for the truth. You won't do that. It's just not human nature. So they were desperate. Jesus is the only one who satisfies. If you haven't found him today and you've been looking for other things, Jesus is the only one who satisfies. He is the one that satisfies the needs of your life. If it were not true, people would find joy and peace and fulfillment in riches and million-dollar houses and fame. But why do all these famous people get married and divorced and married and divorced and married and divorced? Why do they keep doing this? They're looking for fulfillment. You'll never find it in a relationship unless that relationship we're talking about is with the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the only relationship that you'll ever find what the Magi traveled 1,000 miles to find. Jesus is the only one who satisfies. So first stop is Jerusalem. They assume the king will be born there. They meet King Herod the Great. Great, his nickname, because he made the second Jewish temple one of the 7 wonders of the world. Now, Solomon built the first temple. And as you maybe know your history, Nebuchadnezzar tore it down. But then after 70 years, they come back and they rebuild it under the leadership of the scribe Ezra. So they build it back. When Herod comes along down the road, he makes it beautiful. He makes it one of the 7 wonders of the world. In fact, we'll see that as we're going through Jerusalem, that even the disciples will look at that and say, look how magnificent the temple is, because Herod had done all these improvements to it. That's why his name was Great. He would do great building. But he wasn't anything but a great man. Actually, he should have been called Herod the Evil. It's a very evil man, a paranoid dictator, and we see that all down through history. He constantly lived in fear that someone would take his throne. That Augustus, the Roman emperor, said it was safer to be Herod's pig than to be Herod's son. That's true. He murdered 300 officials, his wife. Ladies, aren't you glad you weren't married to Herod the Great? Because he was not a great husband. He was a dangerous husband. He murdered his oldest son and 2 other sons. That's Herod the Great. Murdering innocent people to him was nothing, and we know, we'll see, that it was nothing to him. If you were a threat, he was going to have you murdered. So King Herod was desperate to find the king. Where is born the king of the Jews as the Magi come into town? To worship him? Of course not. He wanted to kill him. That's why he wanted to find him. Now, the chief priests were indifferent. They were experts of the Old Testament. They knew the writings, the history, the prophecies. They knew these prophecies from the Old Testament. They knew where the Messiah would be born. They're the ones when Herod and the Magi asked Herod, they're all together there. Where will the Messiah be born? Where would the king of the Jews be born? It's the scribes that tell them where Jesus was going to be born. It's Bethlehem. They knew it. They're the ones who reveal that. Why didn't they go? Ever thought about that? I've been thinking about this, folks, since Christmas. I've been thinking about Christmas time, and now we're back into Christmas for 1 week. Why didn't they go? Well, you say, well, Pastor, it probably was a long journey for them to get down to Bethlehem. Really? You think that? It was 5 to 6 miles, and we've been there, haven't we, Jeanette? We've been in Jerusalem. And then we travel to Bethlehem quickly on a bus. It's close, 5 to 6 miles. Now think with me. These are the scribes. These are the chief priests. Where is this child going to be born? They've been studying all their life. They've been waiting all their life. They're the ones with the answer for King Herod and for the Magi. Where's he going to be born? Oh, he's not born here in Jerusalem. Micah the prophet said he's going to be born in Bethlehem. So they knew that, and the Magi are ready to go. Why didn't the scribes jump on a wagon, on a horse, on a camel, jump on that? We're going with you. We've been waiting for him. We've been waiting all of our lives. You're going to Bethlehem. We're going with you. But they don't go. That amazes me. Even though they knew where the Messiah was going to be born. The Magi, they come 1,000 miles across the desert to find him. The chief priests weren't desperate for him. So I've been praying this week and about this and thinking about us, I'm concerned that the longer we're with Jesus, the less desperate we are. So I want you to look at me. You know, I do this all the time. Look at me now. Eyeball to eyeball. I'm taking a little rest here, and then I'm going to just wind it up. I'm just going to go for it, all right? So I'm getting ready. You get ready. But we accept the Lord. We're fired up. Oh, we go to every Bible study. We come to church. We love that. We read this every day. But as time goes by, we quit reading our Bible every day. As time goes by, as I talk to some people, hey, I'll see you on Sunday church. No, I can't make this one. I came last week. Why not every week? Are we desperate for Him? Do we want more of Him? Are you satisfied with your life right now? You say, Pastor, I'm not too excited about this sermon. I've heard this sermon, something about Matthew and the Christmas story, if you're older, 50 to 100 times. Not exciting to me. We can never become this way. This has got to be fresh. This is alive. Every day I read, I told you what I do, and I encourage you to do it every day when you read your Bible. Say, Lord, open it up to me. I might have heard the story again, but I can get something fresh out of it every day. Why? Because this Bible, and it's not just my Bible, it's your Bible. Students, I know a lot of times you read the Bible on your phones. It's great. However you read the Scripture. But pray that prayer first. Oh, Lord, open my eyes. Open my heart. I don't want to grow cold. I don't want to grow weak. I want to be stronger than ever. I might have been a Christian 50 years or 50 days. It doesn't matter. But I want to be desperate for more of you. Amen. So I get concerned that we become like the chief priest. We stop being desperate, even though we know that Jesus is the only way to heaven. Would you drop everything to go and see Him? Would you travel 5 or 6 miles to see Jesus? I think you would. If you heard, He's preaching at Vanguard today. They have a special service at Vanguard this afternoon. What's Costa Mesa from here? 5, 6, 8 miles, 10 miles? Would you travel? Jesus is preaching today on campus. Wouldn't we all go? We'd all go to hear Jesus preach, right? But now, would you travel to Dallas today, let's say? Jesus is at a church in Dallas. Wouldn't we all try to find some money and hop on a plane or let's go? I pray that we would. I pray it would never be like old hat with Jesus. Well, I love Him. He knows He loves me. I'm not going to go 1,000 miles to see Him. We got planes. We got cars. We could get down there. We're not talking about camels across the desert. And yet these magi were so desperate for Jesus. Let's go. We're going to find the King. They could have stopped in Jerusalem. He's not in this town. Well, where is He? He's in Bethlehem. Forget it. We've come far enough. We're not going to go down to Bethlehem. I'm thankful. They were tenacious, and they kept traveling till they found the King. Ladies and gentlemen, we got to be desperate for Him. And if you don't know Him, He is what you're looking for. You are desperate, but Jesus is what you're looking for. Are you desperate for Jesus today? Hallelujah. You know, a lot of times the Lord wakes me up in the night, and it's always 3 o'clock in the morning. Now, probably you students were awake at 3 o'clock in the morning. Let's be honest. In San Diego this morning, who was awake at 3 o'clock in the morning? Please raise your hand. A lot of you were sleeping. Here is another miracle from the Lord, all right? That's awesome, all right? But some of it, we don't sleep. I understand that, all right? I get it. If you're awake at 3 o'clock, I was awake in Santa Ana at 3 o'clock. Different reasons, but good reasons. Your reasons are good because ending that conference. Mine was a little different because I couldn't get past the Lord saying to me, aren't I worth it? I just kept thinking about these magi. Aren't I worth your best? Aren't I worth 100% of your effort to worship me, to come after me, to tell people about me? Aren't I worth it over and over again? Yes. And then I had to watch it. I didn't want to wake up Lisa. Yes. covered my mouth. Yes, you are worth it. You're worth that desperation. It's what everybody is looking for. And then I felt like he said to me, aren't I worth the trouble? And I said to the Lord, you're no trouble. You're no trouble. You're worth the effort. You're worth the effort, Lord Jesus. Number two, give your best to Jesus. Verse 9, continuing on, when they heard the king, that's the Magi, they departed, and behold, the star which they'd seen in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. Now, you notice, again, part of our timeline, he's no longer a baby, so it's taken some time. It's taken some time to get down there. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. By the way, if you haven't accepted Jesus Christ, you accept today, you're going to have amazing joy like you've never experienced before. Think about it. When you ask Jesus to forgive you of every sin, every wrong you've ever done, those of us who've done it, it's exciting. It gives us joy. He gives us joy. When you have sin one moment and it's wiped out like somebody erased the slate, that's amazing joy, is it not? If you've asked Jesus to forgive you, yes. Does he give you joy? Maybe some more, you need a little more joy. He gives us joy when he erases all those sins. You haven't done it, he'll give you exceeding great joy. When they had come into the house, they've made it to Bethlehem, they've come in the house where they're living then, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshiped him. And when they opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him. And you may know these treasures that they brought, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, gifts that were symbolic and worth much. Gold, of course, symbolizes the royalty of the king, Jesus Christ. Incense, used, burned, used in the worship. The high priest would use this to worship Jehovah God. It symbolized the worship due to Christ. It's a beautiful smell. Incense burning, the priest would do, as unto the Lord in heaven. And that was, of course, frankincense was incense. And then myrrh symbolizes death and the burial of Christ. They were worth a lot. My wise men did a great job. So maybe this would have been something, at least a symbol, that might have been this other box. But they would have brought gold. It would have been a treasure chest, much bigger than this, that they would have brought to him. Maybe two of them carried it in. Again, there's more than three that came. So the gold, if they used a standard size chest to put gold in, 50 pounds, let's say, of gold would be worth $750,000. That could have been what they brought to Jesus Christ, but they brought a lot of gold in the chest that they brought in. And frankincense and myrrh, you think, that's not worth a whole lot. Hold on. Frankincense, again, that sweet, comes from a plant. Burning sacrifices unto the Lord. It was $500 per pound. So if they brought a lot of frankincense, that was worth a whole lot. And then myrrh, used for embalming, you used it for a dead body because they would stink. Otherwise, we know that we studied Lazarus last year. They didn't use that, obviously, on him. But if you embalm those bodies, myrrh, $4,000 a pound. These gifts that they brought, very significant what they meant. And the cost of those, amazing that they brought across the desert to the newborn king. Used to cover the smell of the body was myrrh. These men gave their best. They gave their best unto the Lord. Have you given your best? Do you give your best to the Lord? Do you give him 100%, those of you who know the Lord, and so many of you do? Finances. Do you give your finances as unto the Lord for his work? Do you give your worship? Now, not just on Sundays. We love that, don't we, Pastor Adam, worshiping when the saints worship with us on Sundays. When we can hear you worshiping, we love that. But we worship through the good and the bad, and we worship every day. We can worship in our car. We can worship wherever we go. We can worship at work. But it's not just singing. It's attitudes too. Good attitudes, because if you have a job and we're working, the Lord gave us that job. We should be giving Him praise for that job, for the strength that we have to do this job, for this brain that works so we know how to do this job. We have a lot to thank Him for or worship Him for. And we do this every day. By the way, it doesn't matter to me, and I preached this sermon before some time ago, this point, it doesn't matter to me. I love them all. If it's a hymn and it lifts up the name of Jesus, I worship the Lord with my all. If it's a modern praise song and it's lifting up the mighty name of Jesus, I worship with my all. It doesn't matter the era. What matters is my heart locking with Him, giving Him praise. We sang a song today that I call a modern day hymn. What a beautiful name. That's a modern day hymn. They were still writing hymns. It would make it into our psalm book. What a beautiful name. You have no rival, no equal. Come on, somebody. That is so true. That's the truth right there. It makes me praise Him. I know that, but I'm reminding today, there is no rival, no equal. Devil's not close to you. No evil person on earth. Nobody's close to you. You are the King. You're the King of Kings. I can worship You, and I can worship You Sunday through Saturday, good times or bad times. In fact, when I'm having a bad time, the worship gets louder in my car. You wouldn't want to be, it's deafening. I'm a little sad, a little depressed. Oh, I'm just going to worship this out of me. This spirit is going out of this car, and I'm going to give Him praise. And I always feel better. I mean, I found in your car, and these things are not sin, okay? But I find if I turn on the news, oh, I'm not necessarily joyful. I know if I turn on sports and I love sports, I'm not necessarily joyful. If I crank the worship, oh, they start saying, how great is our God? How great is Jesus Christ? I can worship any style, every day, good or bad, and this is what we give our best to Him. He deserves it, and that's what He's talking to me about. I'm a little tired like you all today because I was up at 3 too, but He's talking to me and said, aren't I worth it? Aren't I worth your best? And I say, yes, you are worth our best. Finances, worship, and service. He's worth our best, everybody. Right, I got to get a smile on. Is He mad? I'm not mad. I'm happy. I'm like the wise man. I've got joy. Yes, I have exceeding joy too. Jesus Christ, He came. He came. The Magi found Him. The chief priests missed Him. And Herod was a jerk. Should have bowed his knee to the King of Kings and Lord. Should have humbled himself. He missed it. He died. He's in hell now. He missed it. He should have himself gone to bed. He's the King of Kings. I'm going to go find the King of Kings. I'm a king. I'm nothing. I got to go find the King of Kings. But He was too arrogant, too prideful, too sinful, too evil. By the way, if you're sinful, if you're prideful, you got issues today, come to Jesus. All of those things He'll cleanse and He'll take them out of your life. He would have taken them out of Herod's life too. He would have forgiven him. This is our God. This is no way He's too evil. Nobody's too evil. You got to come to Him. Woo, I'm glad I sat down before. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Herod gave his worst. Jealousy, hatred, attempted murder of Christ. The chief priests, indifference toward Christ. Don't grow indifferent toward Christ. Please. They should have ran to Bethlehem too. The Magi, they gave their worship. They gave their best. They gave their best. So, here's some beautiful people yesterday. Except the old guy in back. What in the world? How did this guy get in this picture with all these lovely ladies? That's a beautiful picture. I think we got another one after that. Yeah, here's some more. I love this. I love all the pictures, but this particular table. Now, a lot of these people are related, but the beautiful thing, they all sat at the same table together, and then they took a picture. I love that. That's our family. This is our family. This is what we do. They're not all related, except in Christ. They were related in Christ. Miss Licia and Miss Linda and a bunch of ladies put on a tee yesterday. 80 women there yesterday. 80 women. A bunch of you women were there. Worked hard on this. What's the point? Serving. We don't have a big church. We have 200 people currently are part of this church. We call this church home. Maybe a few more than that who are deciding if they like us or not these days. That's okay. But 200 people, not a big church, but our volunteers, I would put up against any volunteers at any church in America. I don't care Saddleback. I don't care Mariners. I don't care Rock Harbor, all the big ones. I don't care. They're bigger, but they're not better. And you know me, I have a vision that we'll be big someday too. But what we have right now is amazing volunteers. These ladies did an amazing job yesterday. I could show you a picture of what happened on Thursday. A few volunteers feeding our neighbors. On Thursday, our volunteers gave out enough food that will last for a week to 347 families. 347 families times five. 1,500 people got food. And almost every single one of them said, thank you so much, because with inflation, I just can't afford much anymore. And I said, it's our pleasure. And I say this every single car. I'm in the beginning, Josie's at the end, and many of our great volunteers in between us. I said, everyone, Jesus gives us this food freely, and we freely give it to you. It's an honor. It's a blessing. That's our volunteers of this church. You serve, and I have no gripes. Thank you for serving, whether it's putting together incredible programs or whether it's feeding our neighbors or like our outreach we did by Easter. We had to go inside the gym. We had to pivot and shift, and you volunteers were amazing. It rained, and I prayed to the Lord, take the rain away. If it's your will, it wasn't his will. Do we cancel the event? We don't cancel the event. We still open it up. And I went on the street with a sign. This is still happening. And then one of these great ladies named Elizabeth came to the pastor. Don't be out in the rain. I don't care. She took my sign. She's out in the rain, and we filled the gym. All right. We're not going to let anything stop us from loving Jesus and loving people in this community. It's just not going to stop. Praise the Lord. And you're part of it. Wonderful volunteers serving the Lord. Nothing will ever stop God's plan. Matthew 2:13. Now when they had departed, the wise men, the magi, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. I can't wait to get to heaven. Another one I want to meet is Joseph, Jesus' stepfather. This is such a righteous man. He keeps having dreams. I can relate to him. That middle of the night, these dreams. He had dreams, and I have the Lord talking in my ear, but he had these dreams. And this one now saying, remember, he obeyed before, take Mary as your wife. It's of the Holy Spirit, that baby. Now, this time, arise, take the young child and his mother, flee to Egypt and stay there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. And so we love about Joseph so much. Herod knew he'd been tricked by magi. They were not coming back by him. He massacred, we know the story, baby boys under two, and I love that you said that Jesus might have been two, and he might have been two, maybe a little under, but that's why Herod did this. Horrible evil, the ultimate evil that he'd done in his life. But Joseph was warned in another dream by an angel, get to Egypt. Go down to Egypt, Brother Nick. Good to see you today, my brother from Egypt, Cairo, Egypt. Yes. Hanging out down there where our Lord went for a while. Praise the Lord. That's awesome. Great to see you. Well, here it is again. It fulfills prophecy as well. Just that. It's number three. We've seen now these 2 weeks. Hosea 11:1. I'm going to call my son, God says, from Egypt. Who would have ever dreamed that? Why? Why Egypt? Who knew Herod was going to do this? Massacre the boys. Joseph obeyed. I love that. Off he went, and down to Egypt they go for a while to live. They stayed in Egypt until Herod the Great died. By the way, Herod the Great thought he was so great. He's so long gone, and Jesus Christ is still alive, still marching, still sitting on the throne. It's just the way it goes, everybody. Jesus just keeps going on. So what if Joseph had not obeyed? I don't know, but I'm just thankful that Joseph always obeyed, whether it's the angel Gabriel, whoever was giving him marching orders, he always obeyed. So look at it. You walk faithfully with God. You obey his will. Nothing will ever stop your life in Jesus' name. Look at it. You walk faithfully. You obey his will. Nothing's going to stop. All the demons in hell is not going to stop your life. Now, you're not faithful to him. He's always faithful. You're not faithful to him. You don't obey him. You'll probably get into a lot of trouble. Now, you can come back. But if you're faithful to him, you obey what he tells you to do, nothing is going to stop your life in the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise his name. Christmas in April, everybody. How about Christmas every day? You don't have to put up a Christmas tree. By the way, I wear my red shirt today on purpose, right? It's Christmas in April, right? But you don't have to do that. You don't need Christmas trees and all that. Christmas every day. Worship Christ. Worship him every day. I love what some of my friends are doing these days. Brother Johnny and Beck, listening to the word all the time. Every time I walk by him during the week, he's got preaching going on in his ear. I love that. That's how you worship the Lord every day. Get him in here in this world. I love that. It's no doubt, everybody, Jesus is the King of Kings. Praise his name forever. Stand with me this morning. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Worship team, come. Let's review it. Let's not forget it. Are you desperate for Jesus today? If you've never come to him, it's a great day to come to him. If you've kind of drifted, and we all drift sometimes, come back. Come back to him. Number two, give your best to Jesus. You give him your talents, your gifts, your abilities, your finances. Are you giving your best to Jesus? And number three, nothing will ever stop God's plan. Now, I love this from Pastor Charles Spurgeon. We see a wonderful pattern with the Magi. Look at it now. Those who look for Jesus will see him. Those who truly see him, oh, we have to worship him. Those who worship him, they'll consecrate their lives to him. This is true. This is the pattern. This is what we do. He's so amazing. And I would say to you what he said to me in the night, aren't I worth it? Aren't I worth your best? Aren't I worth your worship? Aren't I worth your service? Yes, you are, Lord. Yes, you are. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So you're here. You're desperate for God. You're desperate for Jesus. You've never accepted Jesus. This is the first prayer. You've never accepted him. This is a great day. It's time for Christmas in April. Today, we should accept him if we haven't accepted him. Or we've walked away from him. Come on back. It's time. Why would you wait? Don't wait another day. April, come to Jesus. Raise a hand if I can pray for you that either you've never come to him. I see that hand, brother. You've never come to him. I see that hand, brother. Or you're walking away. You've walked away. You're coming back. You're feeling drawn. If you feel drawn, that's a whole nother conversation I would love to have with you about the Holy Spirit's drawing you back to him. Who else would join these gentlemen and say, I'm desperate for him. I'm desperate for him. First time, or I'm coming back because I've walked away from him. Up top, down low. Praise the Lord. I want to pray for you before we worship him today. Let's pray. Everyone join with me, please. Please pray this prayer. And, well, let me pray one more thing, but we're going to pray for these that are coming to the Lord. Anybody would say, I'm cold toward Jesus. I've drifted a little bit. I'm not as fired up as I used to be for him. I would like to re-fire up, shall we say. Come back to him. When you love Jesus, you just know there was a time you were more fired up for him than you are today. We get it. Cares of life, trouble, battles come. They knock us around. They take the edge off our life. It happens to us all. But would somebody or somebody's say, pray for me, Pastor. I want to get back to being fired up for Jesus. I'm a little cold today. I'm a little lukewarm in my relationship to him because, again, he's worth it. He's worth our all. Would anybody raise a hand and say, pray for me? I need to fire up again. I need to get back. I need to get back to where I was. I've been more on fire for him. I see all those hands. Thank you, Jesus. I see those hands up top. Yes. It happens. I see these hands. The devil fights us. So then we say, Lord, I'm coming back. I may not have much, but I'm going to give it all to you. Praise the Lord. So let's first pray for these that are coming the first time, and then I want to pray a blessing on you, and then we'll all worship. Okay? Please repeat after me, even if you're fired up for Jesus. Let's pray loud. Let's make it easy for these folks to know they have the support of this church on our journey following Jesus Christ. Okay, you ready? Here we go. Lord Jesus, I'm coming to you. I want you to be the Savior of my life. I believe you're the Savior of this world. I believe you're the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I want you. I want this. I want to be close to you. I want to give you my all. I want to give you my best. I believe you're the only Son of God. I accept you. I ask you, forgive me of all my sins and mistakes. I believe not only are you the Savior of the world, but you're the Savior of my life. Thank you, Jesus. In your name, amen, amen, amen. That's why we're here, everybody. That's why we're here. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now, if you need to fire up, put up your hands like this. You're a little cold. You're a little lukewarm. You're a little dry. You love Jesus. But it's easy to drift. It's easy. Me too. I have to stay on it. So, Lord, you see your dear people. I love these people so much, and thank you for making me up to tell them you're worth it. You're worth our best worship, our best giving, our best working, serving. You're worth it. You're so great, Lord. We should share our relationship with you with somebody this week. You're worth it. So what? If they reject it, as long as we do it in love, that we want them to know the way to heaven, they reject it, it's on them. But you are so amazing, wonderful, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. What they're looking for, what everybody's looking for, they're desperate for something, they don't know it, it's you. We should share you with someone this week, or someone's. Help us to do that. Give us boldness. We love you. We praise you. Fire us up. Lord, how do you do that? You draw us close by your Holy Spirit. We need to read your Bible every day. We need to do that. We need to not quit coming to church. We got to keep coming to church so we can be around brothers and sisters and around the Holy Spirit, and we can just stay warm and hot in this day and age where this culture is evil and needs a bunch of on fire loving Christians. That's what this culture needs. So help us to be part of that. We ask this in your name, Lord Jesus. Everybody said, amen. Well, praise the Lord. Praise, yes, amen. So I think we should all come. Let's all come down. Everybody come down. Let's do what the Magi did. They went to worship. Let's all come. We're going to worship together down here around these altars. If you can get down here by me, come on down here, and let's worship together. And join us, and well, it's Christmas in April. Pastor Adam, we should do a Christmas song, but give Jesus all the glory and praise. Amen. Praise God.
Thank you for joining us for Church Online today. I pray that you were blessed by the service and by the word that was preached. If you received Christ today or you need prayer, please contact us. We would love to hear from you. We would love to pray with you. You can connect with us on social media, Facebook and Instagram at OC First Assembly. And also, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. You can check out some of our past videos on there. There are lots of Bible studies and sermons and other videos that will be a blessing to you and in your life. We hope to see you next time. Take care and God bless.